Good day. Welcome to the Sea Power Report. Today's topic: construction of a modern destroyer. The construction of a large surface combatant is an incredibly complex and intricate affair. It is laden with multiple layers of different processes. It requires precise coordination between the shipyards, the naval architects, the engineers, and the key suppliers for the various subcomponents going into the ship. Now, as some viewers may already know, modern shipbuilding relies significantly on modular construction, where prefabricated modules are assembled into the hull inside a dry dock. However, what many people might not already know is that the shipbuilding process actually follows what we call a hierarchical modular approach, where at different stages of the building process, smaller components are progressively assembled into larger sections, and these larger sections get assembled into larger ones before the grand blocks are finally assembled into the actual ship. So it's an iterative and progressive process. The process, which we will talk about today, consists of around five main phases. The first one, the design process, has already been discussed in my previous video. The second stage is the procurement of materials and other key subcomponents. The third is the fabrication of the grand blocks. These are the final large blocks that will be assembled inside a dry dock. The fourth stage is the actual assembly of the main hull, and this will typically be done outdoors for larger ships. The fifth stage before launching is the outfitting process, which starts during the assembly process for the main hull and continues after launch. Parts of the outfitting process continues while the completed hull is moored in the water by the dock. So let's go through each one of these processes in detail. To begin with, let us briefly summarize the design phase, which I covered in my previous video. So the first stage is the conceptual design phase, which basically answers the question, what sort of destroyer do you want? And what sort of missions is it expected to undertake? For example, is the ship designed for fleet air defense, anti-submarine warfare, or anti-shipping and anti-surface strikes, or a combination of the above for a multi-role destroyer? The naval architect then come up with several high-level concepts for the ship for the decision-maker to choose between. Once that is done, the design phase enters the preliminary design phase. The point of this phase is to put more meat on the bones of the design at a high level. Here, the engineers figure out where to put all the different components on the ship at a higher level. At this stage, a tentative cost for the entire project can be estimated, and risk to the project can be assessed. Following this, we enter the technical design phase, where the high-level preliminary design is fully fleshed out, down to the minute details. At this stage, engineers would build a full digital model of the entire ship to check for completeness and conflict, and to resolve these before the ship begins building. So, now that we decided that we do want to go ahead and build the destroyer, where do we start? Well, before we put down any keel blocks, we have to start with the procurement of long lead materials and components, which means ordering the key components and systems that have long production timelines or limited supplier availability. These include propulsion systems, such as maritime engines and reduction gearboxes, naval-grade steel, power generators, combat management system, weapon systems such as the vertical launching systems, and the radar mast. Because these components can take many months or even years to manufacture and prepare, naval shipbuilders must commit to ordering them when the ship's details are still being finalized, and when the ship's construction is only at an early stage. even though much of these systems would not have to be installed until much later in the building phase. Where possible, the fabrication of the smaller sub-assemblies would begin. For example, the individual hull plates, the window frames, the doors, and the bulkheads. These are cut, shaped, and welded into basic units. These components are generally manufactured in specialized workshops using highly precise machine tools and robots technology. However, the fabrication of steel plates for the ship's outer hull, basically the destroyer's belt, cannot begin until the required naval-grade steel, the sufficiently strong high-strength steel, has been acquired. The high-strength steel that could potentially be used include the HY80 or the HY100 high tensile, high yield strength steel. They play a key role in the destroyer's structural integrity, including its resistance to damage and impact. To see the importance of high strength steel in naval construction, we refer to the bombing of the US destroyer, the USS Cole, in the port of Aden in Yemen in October the year 2000, in which a terror group, which I won't name due to YouTube sensitivities around the subject, launched a high-explosive attack on the USS Cole around the waterline. More than 1,000 pounds of C4 explosives were used, and they blew a massive hole measuring 12 meters by 18 meters in area in the ship's port side at around the level of the waterline. Here's a photo of the Cole right after the attack. You can see the massive hole right in the middle. However, what's interesting is that the upper boundary for the hole created by the blast is almost a horizontal line. So what's going on here? Well, if we zoom in closer, we see that the horizontal line sits about halfway between the rail and the water line. This line is the weld line, where two different steel plates of two different strengths and grades were welded together. You can see that the hole created by the blast basically stops at the weld line. Well, to generalize a wee bit, the area above the weld is made out of the HY80, high strength and high yielding steel. Well, the area below the line is made out of a lower strength steel with a lower yield point. And that makes all the difference, because a high yield point, as in the case of the HY80, means that the steel can basically take a greater impact and greater damage without being permanently deformed, leading to a massive hole. Below the yield point, in response to stress or impact, the material will deform temporarily and elastically, before returning to its original shape when the stress is gone. Above the yield point, however, the stress and the impact will lead to a degree of irreversible and permanent deformation, in this case, creating a hole. Therefore, steel plating with a higher strength and a higher yield point leads to a stronger belt for the destroyer. Even in an age where naval ships no longer rely on armor, because of the need to intercept most threats before they reach your ship, using higher grade steel still helps with the survivability of your destroyer, as illustrated by the example of the bombing of the USS Cole. The next step in the destroyer's construction is block fabrication, which I talked about briefly in the introduction. Block fabrication involves assembling all the small components, for example the steel plates, the frames, and the bulkheads, into small blocks, and then assembling these small blocks into medium-sized blocks, before putting these medium blocks together into large blocks, also known as grand blocks. These grand blocks will eventually be transported to the dry dock to be welded together into a completed hull. Block fabrication, also known as modular shipbuilding, is done in controlled factory environments rather than in the dry dock. This approach helps to shield the individual components from the elements and harsh weather before they are fully assembled into blocks. It also allows for parallel workflow, where multiple blocks relating to different parts of the ship can be assembled in different factories. This reduces production time and increases efficiency. Parallel workflow is particularly important for modern shipbuilding, where you have highly specialized teams working on different sections of the ship at the same time. Without the ability to work on different sections of the ship simultaneously, labor force efficiency and idle time for these highly specialized workers would deteriorate drastically. In the block fabrication stage, installation of the pipes, the electrical wires, and the ventilation systems would begin and take place as much as possible. Taking advantage of the easier access compared to working inside a fully completed hull. For example, a medium-sized block destined to become part of the engine room might already have its fuel lines and electrical wiring and ventilation and cooling system installed. Putting these smaller components into the blocks at the fabrication stage is significantly easier compared to when the ship is fully completed in the dry dock or have already been launched. This reduces the need for time-consuming and labor-intensive work in more confined spaces later on. The weld work on the fabricated blocks undergo non-intrusive quality control, using methods like ultrasound and x-rays to detect for defects and ensure that all the welds have been done correctly and to the required level of precision. Quality control and weld inspection especially is a continuous process. So, having now fabricated the grand blocks, the next stage in the construction process is the assembly of the destroyer's hull inside the dry dock. The first phase of the hull assembly phase begins with keel laying, a ceremony where the very first block, inevitably part of the lower hull, is placed into the dry dock. This is done using specialized gantry cranes or other forms of heavy lift cranes or self-propelled modular transporters. The crane places the lower hull block into the dry dock with high precision. Traditionally, in the naval sense, the term keel laying referred to placing a single long beam to form the structural spine of a ship. But this obviously doesn't apply for modern naval construction, including for destroyers, which rely on modular construction methods. The assembly phase involves carefully welding these prefabricated blocks together in sequence and in alignment, gradually shaping the destroyer's recognizable hull form. The first modules to go down, as we discussed, include the lower hull sections, and these include things like the engine room, the fuel tanks, and the keel. Additional sections, such as the midship section, the stern and the bow structures, and the upper decks, are then literally stacked on top of the foundation, or laterally attached. The mid-hull section contains things like the vertical launching systems, the missile launch cells, the crew living quarters, and the storage areas. This is the part of the ship that is relatively likely to be taking hits in naval combat. So, the bulkheads and the belts associated with the midship sections are generally reinforced to withstand damage if they should occur. The use of the HY-80 high-strength steel for the midship section of the USS Cole illustrated this perfectly. Stuff like piping, electrical wires, and ventilation ducts will be connected together between the different modules, as the modules are assembled into a completed hull. One of the final modules to be installed is the superstructure module. That's the part of the destroyer sitting above the main deck, where the bridge, the radar mast, and the smokestacks are. The superstructure is generally built with lighter materials like aluminium or other composites to keep the weights low and to keep the center of gravity for the ship at a lower level, so as to allow a reasonable degree of stability for the destroyer. On top of the superstructure is generally where all the sensors and high-tech radar systems will be placed. Once the destroyer's hull has been fully assembled, the workers undertake a water tightness test, where they literally flood sections and compartments of the ship to check for leaks. If they find any leaks, they have to go back and fix it and reweld it. This is especially important as compartmentalization is key to the destroyer's ability to withstand flooding damage. Once the destroyer hull has been fully assembled and the quality assurance and the testing has been undertaken, the fitting out phase, the parts of the fitting out inside the dry dock, can then be completed. The fitting out phase can begin sometime during the hull assembly phase in the later stages. Fitting out is where the destroyer really starts to come alive. It's like taking a finished shell and wiring it up with electricity, plumbing, and all the electrical gadgets to make it functional. Teams of specialists swarm all over the ship, installing everything, from the massive gas turbines to the propeller to the lighting and the light switches inside the crew cabins. The propulsion system typically goes in first. These massive gas turbines or diesel engines are lowered into place, followed by the drive shaft to the reduction gearboxes and the propellers. Miles of piping snake through the ship for water, fuel, and ventilation. On the top of the deck, the combat-related systems get installed. The missile launchers are lowered into the hole in the deck that is purpose-designed to accommodate the vertical launching system. The big gun turret also gets installed. And the large ASAR radar panels get fitted onto the superstructure. The smaller radars are installed onto the radar mast. Inside, the combat information center slowly takes shape, with screens and consoles slowly taking up what used to be just an empty room. In the bridge room, the steering controls and the navigation system get installed. Even the crew living spaces get special attention. Bunk beds are installed, and galleys are equipped with industrial kitchens, and bathrooms are plumbed in. Fitting out can continue after launch as the new destroyer sits in the water by the shipyard. But the process must be completed before the ship goes on sea trials. By the later stages of the fitting out process, the new destroyer is basically ready to be launched. While some degree of fitting out will still need to be completed, we now essentially have a brand new warship. However, plenty of work is still needed to get the ship ready for naval service. In this video, we have provided an overview of the five main phases of destroyer construction. The first is the design phase. This is followed by the procurement of materials and components with long lead times. After that, we have the fabrication of the block modules, involving small modules being put together into medium-sized modules before being assembled into large, grand modules. These grand modules are then used in the final assembly of the ship's hull inside a dry dock. Along the way, the naval engineers and workers undergo numerous testing and quality control. Finally, the completed hull is outfitted with all the electronics, combat systems, propulsion, and crew living facilities necessary for the destroyer to function. So our destroyer is now ready to launch and nearly ready for sea trials. If you've enjoyed this video, please give me a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe to my channel. See you next time.